Welcome, everybody. My name is Klaas van der Tempel. I work at Studium Generale, and I've helped organize today's lunch lecture. Thank you all for coming. This is part of a series which we've called Global Philosophies. We want to introduce everybody on campus to more familiar and less familiar philosophies, worldviews, oral traditions from around the world, to broaden your knowledge, broaden your insight, and maybe even discover new ways of thinking that could help you in your own life. So, today we have a lecture which very aptly is named A Brief Introduction to Indian Philosophy. We've invited Professor Victor van Bijlert, who is recently retired, I believe, from the University of Amsterdam, spent a lifelong researching and teaching about Hindu philosophy, Hindu religion, and Sanskrit. So this is definitely the man to teach us more, and we've asked him to really give us the basics today. If you have any questions, please keep them for the end. We'll have a few minutes for a Q&A. And without further ado, I'd like you to give a warm welcome to Victor.
Thank you very much. I'm very honored and flattered, actually, to speak at the Technical University Delft, which is different from the kind of humanities surroundings I'm used to. I should perhaps indicate that I'm not from the University of Amsterdam, but the Free University of Amsterdam. Those are two different institutions. You have named it here as a very brief introduction. I myself called it a brief introduction because I thought a very brief, I hope it's brief enough to give you an idea of Indian philosophies or Indian philosophy. We will be talking about ancient philosophies that still have a kind of bearing on modern Indian culture. If you want to understand the Indian philosophies, it is, I think, inevitable that you need to know a little bit about the background where it came from. And if you look at a phenomenon like what we might call Indian religions or Indian culture, or let's say Hinduism even, well, let's use that term, although it's very much under discussion these days, you get the impression of a unity and an enormous variety of different views and different... you see an enormous diversity in the phenomena that are connected somehow with each other as Hinduism. You might say that Indian philosophies did derive, to a large extent, actually, from what we might call Hinduism. And I find these two pictures, I'm not going into the details, but you see many faces. There are incidentally faces of Hindu gods. You see many arms, many other attributes in both of these pictures. Here it's probably, to the left is more male, and to the right it's more a female version of the cosmic unity and in diversity, you might say, or the enormous diversity in unity. Now, what is that unity that we might call Hinduism from which these Indian philosophies derive? First of all, we have to remember that Hinduism is not a textual religion, it's a social model, in fact. And I have on purpose given you this picture of the cosmos as it is conceived in ancient Hinduism as a unity with an enormous diversity. It's an organic whole with a lot of different aspects, and that is what you see here, slightly more focused on the single human body, exemplifying, in fact, two systems, the cosmos to the left and the social order on the right. Now, the social order and the cosmos are considered to be hierarchical in nature. So if you take a man standing up or erect, then the head is the highest and the feet are the lowest. And this also corresponds to the Hindu taboo on touching someone with your feet. You don't do that. I mean, if you do that, that's an insult. If you want to show deference to someone who is higher than you, you touch the feet of that person. It's called the pranam. That is actually still actually quite common. And it's, you could say it's based on this internalized model of the of a hierarchy at which the head represents the priestly class or caste. I'm not going to the caste system. Actually, it's not caste, it's classes. Or below the head, you have the arms, which represent the warriors, the administrators, the rulers of the of the realm. Then you have the producers, the thighs, which bears, as it were, the torso. And you have the feet, which are the lowest rank in society, the servants. This hierarchical model is in a way also to be seen in the, I might say, the modern Hindu mythologies and the modern views on Hindu gods. The highest god is, interestingly enough, in a way, the god Brahma, Brahma. It is, the word is related to a cosmic principle called Brahman, and also to the Brahmin priest. Both in Sanskrit, it's the same word, Brahman. Nam Brahma, it's masculine, means the male god. And Brahmana, someone who is, who has imbued this Brahman, this cosmic principle, or the tradition, in English called Brahmin. Now, the god Brahma is the architect of the cosmos and of the social order, but otherwise he's not being worshipped very much in Hinduism. Brahma is, strangely enough, not actually very important. Who is important is the next one, the god Vishnu and his incarnations, who is in a way a representative of the warrior class, you might say, because he is also wielding weapons. The god Brahma never wields weapons. He is peaceful. He is non-violent. The god Vishnu is actually a violent god, because as a prince, as a warrior, he has to reestablish order and punish the evildoers. And this is obviously not done with non-violence in ancient Hindu mythologies. Then you have another god who probably might have heard of. It's called Shiva, the destroyer, who in a way represents the counterpart to this hierarchical order, the order of, or the sphere of world renunciation, the sphere in which you renounce the social order in order to look for the ultimate truths or ultimate goals, or to, as it were, retreat from the suffering of the social world. Here I've actually given you listed them. Brahmins, the highest, and Kshatriya, the warrior rule, the warriors or rulers, Vaishya, farmers or traders, and then the lowest rank, which is the largest group actually of Shudras, or the lowest servants and peasants. Now this you can to an extent forget, but it shows you the kind of social context in which Hindu philosophy developed. Because, okay, let me just briefly give you some characteristics of Hindu social order. It's basically orthoconformity. You conform to rituals, collectively to rituals and the hierarchical institution of the Hindu society. Orthopraxis. It's not what you believe is important. And I stress this always when I give classes on Hinduism. It's what you do or don't do. What you touch, what you don't touch. From whom you accept cooked food and from whom you do not accept cooked food. These things actually define Hinduism, not the gods, not texts, not other things. Third point is Hindu social order is always local. There is actually no universal Hinduism. It's always a local variant. As you know, perhaps India has 15 official languages and hundreds of sub-languages, and every linguistic group is larger, has more speakers than Dutch. So you can imagine that the communities in India are extremely large, and all these linguistic groups also have their own form of Hinduism, you might say. Lastly, Hinduism is not taught in the form of verbal instruction, like a catechism or a creed. You don't have that. You do it basically through socialization. So a nonverbal kind of instilling the patterns of behavior that a child is expected to conform to. That's the way you actually transmit Hinduism. Now, in order to get out of this system, there is an institution in Hinduism which is called world renunciation, which is, as it were, the exact opposite of this hierarchical order. I won't press this matter very much. If you want to look back at these slides, I will ask the organizer of this course to send them to you by mail so that you can actually look at them again at your own leisure. Now, if you look at the differences between the Hindu social world and the sphere of world renunciation, you see the differences. Social world is hierarchical, world renunciation non-hierarchical. The social world is governed by rules of purity and ritual impurity, which do not obtain that much or not at all in world renunciation. In the social world, you're always part of a network. Individualism is developed in the sphere of world renunciation. Time in the social world is cyclical, hence also the concept of reincarnation. In the world renunciation sphere, time is actually linear. We go from A to B, from suffering to non-suffering, to liberation. And lastly, the social world and its daily practice of Hinduism is actually dealing with daily life here and now. It's not about the hereafter. And world renunciation, in a way, means a kind of living death, because you die, as it were, to the social world. You actually step out of the social world. You don't form part of the social world anymore. And you are actually considered to be, in a way, a kind of dead person. Yeah. In some cases, those who become a world renouncer perform a death ritual for themselves in order to show that they're not part of the social world anymore. Now, the Hindu philosophies have all emerged, with one exception, from the sphere of world renunciation. They were developed by people who were world renouncers, who were striving for final answers to real questions of life and death, which are not answered in the social world and not answered in the social part of the Hindu system. Hence, you might say that Indian philosophy is basically either theology and or philosophy and or sociology, soteriology. So that means a doctrine which, or practices which help you to cope with suffering in the social world and ultimately overcome suffering. Most of these soteriological systems do stress liberation from suffering. And if you remember, perhaps some of you might have heard of Buddhism. Buddhism is actually one of the world renouncing sects in Hinduism. And Buddha actually taught also a soteriology. It's basically not philosophy, it's soteriology. It's a system to get liberation from suffering. Now, we do have ancient texts in which some of these ideas are already a little bit, pronounced explained. These are called the Upanishads. And I will not go into the Upanishads because factually they're not really philosophical. They're more like evocative, poetical utterings of those who speculated about what is the deepest layer of human consciousness. Most of the Hindu texts deal with the question, what is human consciousness? What is the deepest layer of human consciousness? And that was also the main question in the Upanishads, one of the, mystical, philosophical appendices to the Vedic corpus of Vedic texts. Most of the Vedic texts were used to were used in rituals, large rituals that established the social order. The Upanishads addressed those who try to overcome the limitations of ritual and to ask questions about what is the truth, what is really the core of the universe. And then often this idea came up that the deepest layer of human consciousness and the essence of the cosmos are in a way the same or are of the same origin, and that divine principle or the divine essence was often designated as Brahman. Hence, of course, the word Brahma, the male form, means the developer of the cosmos. It sounds all of a sort of proto-philosophical, I would say, but I will show you that most of this is actually completely ignored in the later philosophical systems. This also explains, nevertheless, why in the Indian philosophies, unlike the Greek philosophy, you do not find much interest in the, you might say, proto-science in the sense of seeking the material cause of the universe. Like the ancient Greek philosophers before Plato, so-called pre-Socratic philosophers, are credited with having trying to find what they call the arche, or the origin, the original stuff from which the cosmos was made, but in a material sense, and also as a kind of proto-science that you don't find in Hinduism, because they're basically interested in consciousness, on the, let's say, the perceiver of the cosmos, not the essence, the material foundation of the cosmos. Yeah, I've actually, this is basically what I've, a summary of what I've just said. There are a few schools, like I mentioned them here already, Vaisheshika and Nyaya. We'll go into some detail later. Neither of these two schools look at first sight at look like soteriology, but they are soteriologies, and even though they have developed some form of looks like proto-science, scientific thinking, it's really not for the adherence of these schools. It's basically not the not important. Even though, for instance, Vaisheshika, this is just incidentally, had conceived of the ultimate matter in the form of atoms. And these atoms were, according to Vaisheshika, also globular in shape, which is quite remarkable, because why do you come to such an idea? It's just an idea. And the idea was that you cannot divide matter indefinitely. So ultimately, you have an ultimate smallest particle, smallest piece of matter, and you can't divide it further. And that has to be globular, but they never explained or tried to explain how all these little pebbles or these globules would stick together and make up larger entities. That was never developed. The philosophies that ultimately did develop, I said seven systems of thought. Actually, there are more, but these are the more well known. Were usually designated as darshana, that means seeing, a way of seeing. You might actually say something like a worldview. What is also important to notice is that they are not complementary. They all six or seven fundamentally differ from each other. They have different ways of analyzing the cosmos, and also different ways of analyzing the way to be liberated from suffering or from rebirth, which is in some cases a standard doctrine, but not in all cases. And this is, I think, typically Indian. You can choose from these systems what you like. You can actually amalgamate them also a little bit, which has been done in later times. And if you don't like them, you just take another, or you discard all of them. That's also possible. It's the same actually with the religious practice as well. I mean, it's very much unlike Hindu practice. You can worship a particular god, and if you don't like him anymore, then you take another, which you like better. If you don't like this sacred scripture, you take another sacred scripture. If you don't like this guru, you look for another one. Or you just discard gurus at all, altogether. This is very well possible. I've listed here what I think are the most important ones, which you will always find in books on Indian philosophy. The first one is a Mimamsa, which is actually not philosophy, but basically interpretation and discussion on the meaning of the Vedic texts. So it's you cannot actually, if you look at it, you see that it basically discusses details of, for instance, of Vedic ritual. So in that sense, it's not philosophy. Then you have Vedanta, which is probably the most well known in the West, which claims to discuss and summarize the teachings of the Upanishads. The Upanishads are the last section of the Vedas. Mimamsa is about the Vedic ritual. The Vedanta is actually about the mystical insights of the Upanishads. Then you get a rather important one. It's called Sankhya. And Sankhya does not derive from any Vedic text. It's an independent school. It has always probably initially been an independent school which emphasized calculation or analysis or reckoning of the ultimate, you might say, the ultimate elements of which human experience consists. I'll give you the scheme later on. And you get the doctrine of Vaisheshika. Vaisheshika was an innovation. It also has totally different categories from Sankhya. Doesn't have the same categories. And Vaisheshika's main question was, what is the ultimate good? And how do I define the worldly good? That's how the text starts. But then subsequently, it starts to analyze reality in terms of grammatical categories. So this is actually one of the first systems after Sankhya that produces a list of ultimate categories, among others atoms, which you cannot below which you cannot go. These are the ultimate six categories of reality according to Vaisheshika. Then you get the Nyaya philosophy. This is probably the first really philosophical system in which the method of philosophical debate and logic and epistemology are being developed or used and linked to a soteriological goal, namely to find ultimate insight and ultimate liberation. Then probably also quite well known is yoga. Yoga is a system of meditative discipline which uses, or you might say synthesizes, ideas from Buddhism, mostly from Sankhya, and a little bit of Vedanta into a new system. And then these ones I find actually also quite interesting, the Charvakas, which you probably won't find in many books on Indian philosophy. These are the so-called skeptics or even atheists. They're also designated as atheists or nihilists. The systems, as I've described here, are all found in, you might say, foundational treatises. Usually every system has one foundational basic text. And that basic text is in Sanskrit and usually in the form of very small small prose sentences, aphorisms put together, usually in the form of definitions, explanation of the definition, and discussion of the definition. I mean, Mimamsa Sutra is the longest of these texts, and its main interest is in the sacrificial duties So it is in for our modern purpose, it's not really a philosophy. What is interesting, for instance, is that the old Mimamsa Sutra does not emphasize the existence of reincarnation, which in most cases you associate with Hinduism or with Hindu philosophies. Nor do they believe in God. They have no God. Yeah, they have the Vedic gods, but those are kind of higher beings that have to be, as it were, controlled with the help of the Vedic sacrifices. And they regard the Vedic sacrifices and the texts describing them as eternal sources of knowledge, per se. Most of the Hindus are totally unfamiliar with this system. It's not a very popular system. It's a system that was probably mostly studied by a handful of Brahminical experts in this particular way of thinking. And Vedanta Sutra is later than the Mimamsa Sutra. It's also much shorter, and its goal is to investigate Brahman. It says at the very beginning, this is what we are going to investigate. Also in the form of very brief aphoristic sentences. So you do need a commentary to make sense of this text. You might say that Vedanta is has become, certainly since probably the 11th, 12th century, together with yoga, sort of the two poles of Indian philosophy and Indian religion per se. So most, you might say, most modern Indian or most Hindu religious persons would always say that they actually adhere to the Vedanta, but that doesn't mean that they study this particular text. The most important systematizer of Vedanta was a commentator from the 8th century, Shankara, who introduced or who used the concept of non-duality to explain the Vedanta. You will see that in the Vedanta Sutra, this whole idea of non-duality does not appear. It's not there, but it's later, it was later introduced from Buddhism into Vedantic later texts. And Shankara, in the 8th century, brings all this together in one sort of, you might say, encompassing system. But he was not the only one. You get later ones like Ramanuja, who, again, do not believe in non-duality, and they explain Vedanta in a different way. But you might say that this probably, we would probably consider Shankara and Ramanuja more like theologians, even in the Christian sense of the word, than as philosophers. Then you get the system of Sankhya, which I mentioned as in my list. The basic text of the Sankhya is, interestingly enough, not a text in small aphorisms, but in 70 verses. It's also not extremely old. It's from the 4th or the 5th century. And it's clearly summarizing all the doctrines or particular brands or particular strands in the doctrine of Sankhya. But Sankhya has been, the scheme of Sankhya and the, you might say the terminology of Sankhya has been, you might say, you find it in almost every Hindu text, you find terminology of Sankhya. So it's, for instance, a text like Bhagavad Gita, which is a very popular Hindu text, uses terminology that is derived from Sankhya. So Sankhya is, even though the system itself is hardly practiced, to my knowledge, there's no one who practices this system as a philosophical system. Its schemes and its terminology is to be found almost everywhere. Far more than all the other philosophical systems. Now, in order to give you an idea, the Sankhya is based on a dual concept. On the one hand, you have pure consciousness, which he says is the inner witness of everything that happens. And they call this inner consciousness Purusha, man. It literally in Sanskrit means man. And that's a passive atomic small individual entity of consciousness, which you find in every living being. Every living being is, in fact, an atom small purusha, an atom small passive consciousness. Everything else that is found around that consciousness, that is the object of that consciousness, is called nature or prakriti. And that nature is being divided in ultimately 24 different categories, which the first list, I mean, from if you go to the left to the right, you see the word prakriti, and you see a number of psychological faculties like intellect, and then ego, and then you see here you see manas or mind with an arrow. These are the inner part of the nature, or the psychological or the subtle part of nature. And these things, these four lines of five, or the four lists of five elements, are based on the concept of the five different sensory forms of sensory perception: hearing, feeling, seeing, tasting, and smelling. And they theorize that every sensory faculty has a particular object, a particular material object, which is called a gross element. So you have five elements in that is all, that's universal, in fact. And the five elements are somehow brought in connection with these five sensory forms of sensory perception. It's also interesting that there's actually nothing else beyond this. So this exhausts what is humanly possibly experience as a human being. I've made it a bit I think this is a bit easier in this way. So you have the pure awareness of the Purusha. It's always an inner witness. And then you have, again, opposite Purusha, you have Prakriti, or nature, which is everything else, starting with the first three psychological faculties, and then you get the five senses of perception, powers of movement, five forms of sensory impression, and the five elements. And if you want to know exactly, then you go back to the previous slide. I think the most significant thing with the Vaisheshika Sutra, which is totally different from Sankhya and also has different categories, is the analysis of reality in six categories: substance, properties, activity, specificity, generality, and inherence. Now, these first three are also grammatical categories: nouns, adjectives, and verbs. And these are, you might say, are almost physical things. So you have specific objects, you have generality, many objects having the same property, and smaller classes that inhere in larger classes. This approaches also actually theories of knowledge and theories of logic. But it is a liberation theory because it promises to help you liberate yourself from suffering. I think I'll leave it at this. This is last one is Nyaya Sutra, which is in a way based on the Vaisheshika Sutra, but is more systematic. It systematically describes the elements of logic, of epistemology, and a detailed discussion of the way one conducts philosophical debates. Patanjali Yoga Sutra is a brief text of 200 aphorisms on the practice of spiritual discipline known as yoga, the way the different levels of meditational concentration. And it says that the goal of yoga is a cessation of the activities of consciousness. It's the first definition, and actually all the rest of the text flows from that first definition, or tries to explain that first definition. This one, I think, is still actually quite interesting. The Charvakas is a different system. They also had a sutra text which has not survived. And they claimed that the truth of everything is four elements: earth, water, fire, and air. I mean, at least those things that can be directly perceived with the senses. Everything else, they claim, is there's no proof for that, and therefore can be discarded as unimportant. That means that they discarded the canons of logic. They didn't believe in the existence of the hereafter, no reincarnation. Human consciousness does not survive death. And Vedic rituals are clearly not necessary to be performed. So this is... Patanjali is probably one of the only philosophers to date who is a mystical, a mythical figure, actually. There's not much reason to assume that he actually existed. But his text, the Yoga Sutra, is so popular nowadays, there are hundreds of translations of that in English alone, that recently they made a large statue commemorating his writing of that text. But this is an invention of tradition of maybe the last 20 years. Vedanta was probably more popular in the 19th century than the Yoga Sutra initially, and was popularized by figures like Ramakrishna, who was a born mystic and whose teaching allegedly promoted a modernized form of Vedanta, looking back at the Upanishads and Bhagavad Gita. He was a priest in this temple in North Calcutta. This is my own picture. This particular temple, which is devoted to the goddess Kali, the black goddess. And his pupil, his most famous pupil, was Swami Vivekananda, who sort of started a modern movement of blending Vedanta with yoga. He was also the first one, probably one of the first, to popularize the practice of yoga meditation on the basis of Patanjali's Yoga Sutra in the United States. And since then you see a rise of an increase in interest in the practice of yoga. I mean, he is allegedly one of the persons who has started this this tradition. I think I should stop here, because this is also the end. I could go back to the previous one if you wanted to. You can have an idea.
Let's leave it there for now. Thank you, Victor. So that was a lot of information.
It's a bit too much, I think. But
well, it's an ancient tradition with a lot of different branches, and you tried to cover a lot of it. I personally have some questions, but I'm also curious. First, I want to give you guys a chance. Is there anybody else who has a burning question to kick it off? If you ask the question, I'll repeat it in the microphone. I'll repeat the question. So the question is, are a lot of these insights given or attained, reached through introspection and meditation, or otherwise, so like through logic or experimentation?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question. I think the Upanishads, if you look at the way the large prose Upanishads are composed, It does not seem to have been derived from much meditation, because they also don't teach anything like meditation. There, I think, there may be either speculation or mystical insight, but it's difficult to speculate, because you have no traces of any description of any practices of meditation. Yoga Sutra, on the other hand, of course, it's full of this kind of instructions, but it's the only one that has this system of meditation. It's certainly not the only. It's certainly not the first text on meditation. I mean, there were earlier texts or there were earlier practices which probably were not described in written texts. For instance, even the Nyaya Sutra, which is a text dealing basically with philosophical debate, also says that ultimate knowledge has to be derived from yogic meditation. So yeah, it is possible that there is a lot of meditational practice at the back of it, which would be explicable from the fact that these people who wrote these texts were probably, most of them, were world renouncers, so that was also their main, one of their main daily practice to meditation. Although it's, yeah, that would be my brief answer. I don't see that in Mimamsa Sutra, though. Mimamsa doesn't believe in meditation. They don't do it. They say the Veda, actually the Vedanta also doesn't. The old Vedanta Sutra doesn't criticizes other schools already. It says you have to have the authority of the Upanishadic texts is enough. Meditational practices are not enough to reach ultimate insight.
I find it an interesting question too, because nowadays, especially in the West, what we know is mostly the meditation, the yoga, right? If we know anything about Hindu philosophy. You mentioned near the beginning of your lecture also that actually it's not so much about what you believe, but what you do. It's the practices. So yeah. There's a bit of a theme there. Can I ask a personal question about that? Because this has been a lot of academic information, but you've spent a lifetime researching this. What has it done for you, studying Hindu philosophy and religion?
It probably made me, first of all, very skeptical, like these Indian philosophers themselves were.
Skeptical about
many claims, for instance, of latter-day gurus. Because these are not, you find nothing of this in the ancient texts. I mean, these ancient texts are, on the whole, very rational, very empirical in their approaches. That doesn't mean that they deny the possibility of higher insights, but they do not make tall claims. Which I think some modern schools do, in fact. So then, of course, my wife is a Hindu, and you might say, because our son, we were born in India, but and we often went there, so you see the socialization of a child. It was, of course, an upper caste, highly educated Hindu family in West Bengal. And West Bengali, the Hindus are known to be quite leftist and critical of North India. So, yeah, I don't know exactly what it did. I was engaged with a business school where we were taught to practice a form of meditation. And at some point, I was fed up with it. So I don't know exactly how to answer this, either in positive or negative sense.
It made you a cynic, basically. yes, sir, question. You mentioned the ancient Greeks and how they came to think about the basic units of matter, but you said that wasn't so important in Indian philosophy. But this gentleman is saying, well, there actually is an example of it. I don't remember exactly what you said the last part.
It's undifferentiated efficient and material cause. They are one and the same.
Okay. Undifferentiated material efficient cause.
Yeah.
Did you get it, Victor?
Yeah, I get it.
It was for me.
this is, of course, I think this is an Advaita point of view, a non-dual Vedantic point of view. But I think one, as I said also, many people nowadays believe that the Vedanta doctrine, or the non-duality especially, is the Hindu doctrine. And I hope to have shown that is at least needs a lot of qualification. It's not actually probably has not been true for all ages. It is true that since probably, certainly, I mean, since the 15th century, you see that yoga, for instance, Yoga Sutra is not, it's not the Advaita, it's not the non-dual, it doesn't believe in Mayavada, it doesn't believe in any of that stuff, it doesn't have it, it actually denies that it's valid to have such ideas. Later on, in the 15th century, this was blended with a sleight of hand as if it's all one. And of course, the earliest text that does this is Bhagavad Gita, because it has blended Upanishad with Sankhya and Yoga. All three are actually not really that compatible. So yes, I would agree with you. There were, what I tried to say is that in Greek philosophy, you see no, certainly not in the pre-Socratics, any elaborate doctrine about what is human consciousness. The analysis in Indian texts is far more, let's say, far more detailed in that respect. But they do not ask, what is, of course, you can say the foundation of cosmos is Brahman. Yeah, of course, that's it. But the Greeks have tried to, if they find out, is it water? No, of course, that's not true. Is it air? Is it this? Is it earth? Ultimately, they come with four elements. And you have philosophers who say, no, it's actually atoms. Of course, the Vaisheshika doctrine with the atoms comes. I can't explain where the Vaisheshika got its atomic doctrine from. I think it's just through reasoning. You find in Nyaya Sutra actually a description of how you get to such a doctrine, namely, you cannot indefinitely divide material objects. At some point you have to stop, because otherwise there's nothing left. But of course there were doctrines, like Buddhist philosophers said, yeah, there is nothing. Yeah, it's all consciousness. This is the doctrine of Vasubandhu and Nagarjuna, which are actually left out, but they should have been included, perhaps.
You wanted to confuse us even more.
Then it becomes even more complex.
Victor, we have to wrap up. We have time for one more question. Is there somebody with a question in the back or over here? Last question. So the question is, you've portrayed the different schools coexisting, not necessarily complementary to each other, but still, like, you can choose. Yeah. If you're a Hindu, like, well, I like this practice, I like that god or goddess, whatever. The question was, what can we learn from that in our society?
It's probably a good idea of diversity, because you have, I'm thinking actually there was one philosopher in the 9th century called Vachaspati Mishra, and he wrote commentaries on all these basic texts as if he were an adherent. When he wrote the commentary, he wrote as an adherent of that particular school, criticizing the rival school. And if he wrote from the rival school's point of view, he criticized the former school. So apparently, this is what you might... It shows to me that these Indian philosophies, and I've always said, are not about ontology. They have a sociological and soteriological meaning. So if they produce the liberation, that's okay. If they don't, no, yeah, you look for another one. It does seem that the truth, or the idea of verifiable truth, seems to be a bit loose. Although not all schools would agree to this. Nyaya Sutra, for instance, was instrumental into bringing the doctrine of verifiable proofs as part of epistemology into all the other later doctrines, because they all couldn't ignore Pramanavada. This should maybe mean something to you, the word Pramana. Yeah. So I think what one can learn is to, probably be quite rational and critical, and also don't take all the claims very seriously and analyze them for yourself. I think that's what they did also. That I think I would have learned from these guys.
That sounds a bit like agnosticism.
Yeah. If you really press it, I think they were agnostic in a way. Yes.
Victor, can you show us the last slide real quick? The next one, the very, very last one. Yes, this one, because we're wrapping up. We're
okay,
done.
Sorry. Yeah, I'm
with
sorry.
The Q&A. Victor, do you have a few minutes to stay behind for people if they have more questions, but maybe they didn't dare to ask in front of the microphone? I want to thank you all for coming today. Again, this is part of a series, so there are more events coming up. In a couple of weeks, we have an event on philosophy in Africa. We have also a lecture coming up on Vinti, which is a Afro-Surinamese religion, which is also being practiced in the Netherlands today. Very interesting. So yeah, sign up for these, please join us again. And of course, this is being recorded. Other lectures have been recorded, so you can find these on YouTube. I want to thank you all for coming today, and thank Victor. See you guys next time.